Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Good evening, and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host. The Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen is one of 11 chapters of the Pennsylvania Guild of Craftsmen. And so we have a membership of well over 140 artists, and one of those juried fine artists is with us tonight. Her name, Diane Phalen. Welcome, Diane.
Thank you, Kay.
You're welcome. She is a fine artist who paints in watercolors, and I'm going to say she quilts with watercolors, too. You will see what I mean shortly. Okay, and Diane, tell us what you're going to do for us here tonight.
Going to demonstrate some watercolor painting.
Yes, you are. And so that's going to make everyone want to just
get out their paints and get going painting.
Yeah. So let's first start. Why don't you start and tell us how you got interested in this at the tender age of 13?
13, yes. Yeah. I always liked to sketch. So I was always in the woods sketching. That was my thing. After school, we had a lot of woodlands around our house. So I would take my sketchbooks and either ride my bike or walk into the woods, and I did a lot of drawing, and that got me really interested in drawing part, and then eventually it led into wanting to do things in color.
Okay, because that was your mom and dad who
yes.
got you started in that,
yes,
right?
Yes, they did. They got me my first oil painting kit at 13, and so I began painting in oils, and I really enjoyed doing that. I enjoyed getting to know color. It was quite an experience. But I think it was nice having the foundation of the black and white. And because you got to see one thing with black and white, you have to add the shadows. And so I got more aware of shadows and dimension. And so then I interpret that into my color with the light colors and dark colors.
Yeah. Well, I think when and you were pretty much self-taught, right?
Yes.
I mean, you know,
yes,
at the
definitely.
Age of, I mean, you were doing this before 13 because
yes.
you were, you know,
yes.
You know, so your mom yelled out the back door, "Where are you, Diane?"
Yes.
Right?
Always.
She found you in the woods.
Yeah, she's always in the woods, still to this day.
And you were local to this area.
Yes, I grew up in Bethlehem.
In Bethlehem,
yes, Pennsylvania.
Okay. Yes, very good. Okay, so so this, of course, led you into your career. I mean, what was your chosen, when you went to college, let me just get into that part.
Well, I took drafting. I was going for engineering. I did great at the drafting because it was drawing on the board. I did very well there. But when it came to the math part of the engineering, I struggled, like most artists do struggle with math. And I did, so I got to a certain point where it was more of a struggle. And I really loved doing my art. And so I love the drawing part. In fact, I got caught a couple times when I was drafting of drawing instead of using the templates. At that time, it was all hand board. And
so today, they call it old school,
old
right?
Old school. You know? It was old school before computers.
Yeah, but that you loved it, and it was a part of you, you know?
Yes.
But they never complained about your drawings, right?
No, they didn't. I mean, only one man caught me. One of the supervisors caught me. He said, "Did you hand draw this?" And I did. And he said, "That's a no-no. You got to use templates." And so.
But you stayed in, I mean, that was your career then.
I did technical illustrating for a while, which was really neat because you took the parts that you had to use templates too, but you took everything apart and you had to hand draw it. So visually, I was good at that also.
Okay, so your art then was kind of like put on the back burner for
a little
bit.
Yeah, I was still painting.
Yeah.
I was still
working. Oh, you
working.
Still were. Oh,
yeah,
okay.
I was still doing oil paints at that time.
Okay.
I'd say well into my, probably into my 20s, I was doing oil paints. And then I got allergic to the turpentine.
Yeah,
I got headaches all the time and was opening windows and nothing was working. And
yeah,
so,
that's unusual. I mean, maybe not unusual, but you know, I mean, it definitely made you. How did you find that out? That it was just that, just by trial and error.
By always getting a headache every time I painted, I knew something was. I was just, and they were severe. I mean, they were migraines. So
yeah, okay, so that
put
you out.
So then I took a watercolor. I took like a 1 week watercolor, like a little workshop with a man called Zoltan Szabo.
Oh, okay.
Who has quite a few books. He's long gone, but he kind of taught me about the watercolor and Well, sure. So I took it from there.
Yeah, the 1 week class. Yes. Now, you were still working at that point.
Yes, full time. Yes.
And you were out in California, right? Yes. I mean, you know, let's just, you know, get
that
out.
Yeah, I lived in California.
You lived in California.
And Oregon for about 26 years mm-hmm. total.
Okay. And so when you took this watercolor class, then it was instant, I love this.
Yeah, I really loved it. I really, really did. There was so much you could do. I mean, so many techniques and I just scratched the surface in that class, and I ended up reading a lot of books on watercolor and mm-hmm. and just experimenting to this day still on my own with watercolor. Mm-hmm. I'm still learning things with watercolor after all these years.
Yeah, well, it's not that many years.
It's a lot of years, as we both know.
We're not going to go into
no.
that. We don't have to tell that.
No, we're not telling that one
this
today.
This is not true confession.
No.
But anyway, so yeah, we've been around a while.
Yes.
So then you got into the watercolors, okay, and yes. So then you were encouraged to go back to your art.
Yes.
Okay, you know, yes. And it's fair for me to say that's when it all began,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it did. It's when it all started, just doing nothing but painting and mm-hmm. and then leading it to the shows and doing a lot of shows mm-hmm. and to supplement the income part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I had to have an income also, so I started doing a lot of shows, yeah. a lot of art shows, the fine art shows.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess let's just, talk about some of your paintings here,
yes.
and then you'll tell us how those quilts got into all
oh,
those.
Yeah.
That's what you're famous for,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I'm famous for the quilts, and that was one painting that led to all the rest. And
uh-huh.
I did one painting and included several quilts hanging out on a railing in front of a country store,
mm-hmm.
and that led to having it at a show and quilters coming up to me and liking that one so much, and then they introduced me to their shows of quilt guilds,
mm-hmm.
and I was the only painter at the shows. Everybody else was making quilts or selling quilting products like
mm-hmm.
like threads and fabric, and mm-hmm. so I was the only painter, but I was painting things that they could enjoy, their quilts in their studio. They could have a painting,
sure.
and then they could have a note card to send a friend
yeah.
with quilts, and it just kind of snowballed.
Yeah, yeah. Well, because it appealed to artists and quilt makers are artists, you know, they just
yes.
use fabric and thread
yes.
and needles.
Yeah, they're
and
quite the artists.
Yes.
They are. It's very much an art form.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And so I can see how you certainly would appeal to, you know, to that,
yes.
you know, because they all love color.
They do.
Know?
They're awesome with color. And,
yeah.
And it's fun how color has evolved in quilting as well as art.
Oh my goodness,
the
yes.
The colors
yes.
are so intense and so mm-hmm. realistic and not like the pale, real pale colors mm-hmm. of yesterday. Now mm-hmm. it's real and bright.
Well, even as, you know, when we get to the class, you're
yes,
all
yeah.
going to be in Watercolor yeah, 101
to
today
see,
with Diane.
See how
but
it's done.
I think most of us, you know, who were exposed to watercolor maybe just in high school, you know, in art class and stuff, it was very pale.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
you know.
It was pale and it was in hard cakes on the,
uh-huh.
you know, on and today I use paints right out of the tube, which wasn't, at that time was always hard cakes. Even the class I took with Zoltan Zabel always had you take the tube of paint and squirt it out and let it harden. And
oh.
then you used it. But it's like, why? Because you don't get the colors, the
okay.
intense
and
colors.
Yes.
So.
And that's what I was going to say. We were so used to it being so pale.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you know, you thought of watercolor being very pale.
Yes.
You
and
know.
It isn't.
And yours is far from
yeah,
pale.
Yeah, I'm very intense. I do a lot of layering, which I'll be showing mm-hmm. how I layer the color
yeah.
to get it so bright.
Yeah, yeah. So it's so beautiful. You want to show what, you know, talk about any of these that we have so beautifully displayed in
yeah,
the front
actually, this
here
was
for
the
you?
One I did
this
just
one?
Recent. And
oh,
it doesn't
this
have,
one?
As you notice, it doesn't have quilts in it. There's a fox in my backyard that comes through, and he was just begging to be painted, so I did. And I did with the snowflakes. I call it snowflake kisses. So they were going down and on the fox, and he was looking up at the
yeah.
at this. At
May
the
I
snowflakes.
Ask you a question, Diane? How did
yeah.
you get him to sit there that long?
Oh, he
so
just posed.
Could...
He was just
oh,
really.
Yeah.
My fox usually just goes right through. As soon as he sees me at the window, even he takes off. So he's a wild animal. So I had. I had to take a lot of pictures, which I did, through my window.
Okay, and I was going to ask you about that, too.
I took a lot of pictures
of him. At this point, may I just, we're going to talk about fabric a little bit, jumping ahead here.
Jump ahead to fabric.
But then look at this.
Yeah, that was a fabric. I do fabric now with a company called Spoonflower, and the nice thing about them is they print as you need the fabric. So they're more expensive, and it's digitally printed.
Okay.
So the colors, I was really surprised how intense they got the colors. I tried to sample, and now I'm selling panels of my paintings, too, at the shows.
Yeah, now, so a quilter might take this, you know, buy this panel, and then quilt, you know, put the batting in, you know, layer it, and probably could do a pick, you know, a wall hanging,
or turn
it into bags, right?
You know, a bag or a tote bag,
You know, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, definitely.
So that, so that's really, really, really beautiful, and
very
into quilting. I mean, the quilters love this
thing.
They
do.
Know,
and so. They like
and for people just starting in quilting, it's not overwhelming.
No, that's true.
You know, when
you already have the panel instead of, you know, having to cut off all the little pieces. And there are some quilters that will cut it into little pieces. And,
oh, they will.
You know,
make
it into a montage or a painting. Or they have a technique they call fussy cut, which they cut into little pieces and it kind of makes it into more like of an abstract. So I'll get to see what they do with it at the shows. I'm excited.
Okay, so is this more recent then that you've done this
that
just
was
a little
one
more
of my
recently?
Newest ones, yes. I just finished that one in December. So it's brand new.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I just was trying to think, how did you get him to pose?
Yeah,
but
was,
you do take pictures then
I do, a lot. I do. I take him out my window. So I do, I'm always looking in the woods and there he is. So.
Why would we not think he would live near woods, you
know. Of course. I have to have my woods.
Most people worry about two bathrooms or whatever.
Yeah,
Diane worried about woods.
I have to have woods. I know. That was my stipulation of where I was going to be. So.
Yeah. Okay. And then as you got into the quilting, I mean, you know, going to all the quilting shows, because you always incorporated a quilt in all your pictures, as they can see down there. Do you want to explain any of
sure,
these, or
yes.
you know, you can take a walk?
I can take a walk.
Yep.
Okay.
Here, let me.
She's gonna put my mic on.
I'm gonna. So you can walk around
thank
there.
You.
Okay.
Okay. I'll go over and I'll show you.
It'll
what
be
I
nice
have
for
here.
You to explain
yes.
some of these. Yes.
This one, I had to bring this because it's spring. It's going to be spring eventually, right? So this was a spring one, which I went a little crazy. I even put some fluorescent paints in here too. There's some interference type colors and duochrome type colors in watercolors. So I did that. And of course, I have the quilts, the spring quilts, the Valentine quilt, and then the quilts down there too, and the cardinals, which I have a lot of those in my yard too. And then over here, I did this one, of course, for Kutztown. I do when I do the folk festival. I had a
she does the Kutztown folk festival
with the hex signs, and then this is the welcome pineapple quilt, welcome as they say in Pennsylvania German. This one was fun. This I did for last Easter. This was something completely different for me. It was gnomes have been, as you know, from going to the stores, gnomes are like the biggest thing right now. So this one was an Easter gnome with the bunny slippers.
Okay.
Bunny
so
slippers.
There's no quilt there, but I see his
no.
little shirt under
his
there. You know,
got
kinda,
some.
You know,
and then if you look at all these here too, they have all little patterns.
Yep, yep.
So it's got the Easter egg hat.
And you got that in there.
And this one is different too. This one is more of a the purple chuck, and then the Easter eggs are quilted. And of course, the barn has a quilt.
Yeah.
And all the Easter eggs have quilt patterns too. So this one was done also.
You have a great imagination.
Yeah, I do. I do.
Very nice.
Well, thank you. I'll just show these briefly too.
Okay.
This little guy is for St. Patrick's Day, another gnome.
Well, so, yeah, he's very at home on St. Patrick's
he'll
Day,
be,
I would say,
yeah,
right?
He'll be drinking his green beer and picking his daffodils there. And this, of course, is Valentine's Day with a heart in the snow and one of the covered bridges in Allentown, where I live. So it's nearby. There's three of them on the Jordan Creek.
Very nice.
And last but not least is the rose. how to do love roses. And this is a rose quilt pattern mm-hmm. with the hummingbird. And so.
And now you've told me that you've designed, I believe, like what, over 500 quilts?
Yes, at least 500. Should I come back there?
Yeah, okay. Or you know, you're going to soon get ready to,
I'll
to
be
do
careful with that.
Painting 101 here.
We're going to do painting soon.
You know, but you have these 500 quilts. Designs. I mean,
yes.
Your drafting days had helped you do that,
they
right?
Did.
You know, because
they really did.
You know, even though you said you weren't good in math,
you still figuring out with the corners and the. Mm-hmm. You know, I guess I did pick up some of that.
Oh yeah, and well, geometry enters into this.
Yeah,
so
did.
this is why children pay attention to math. Okay.
Yes, you, that's true. That's true. You have to have math in life, even though you don't want to, you have to have it.
So. Because I think that's one of the questions kids go, what am I going to do with this? You know, I mean,
yeah.
Not all. I mean, you know, I think so math is very
like
important.
Algebra, it's like, you know, I don't know, but I guess we use it all the time. We're not even aware we use it.
yes, that's so true. Okay, well, we did promise. Okay,
yeah,
Diane, I had this idea. I went to the craftsman and I said,
Kay's
you know what? I think we need to have some lessons on our Your Berks Craftsmen, okay?
Yes, definitely.
And people are so interested in what we do as craftsmen.
Yes.
And I thought that this was going to be the year that we're going to take a little.
Yeah.
do a few lessons, you know, in this. So you're going to help us do that.
Yes.
And
here, I'm going to move this so I'm not bumping into it. And what I did pre-lesson is I did some different little techniques here that I use in my watercolors. This is what I call the first wash in a watercolor. One thing that's very important when you paint is to get the shadows in. So this is the shadows that I've put in already. And I'm going to show you how I do that. This one's all ready to go, but I'll show you how I do a shadow. I'll just pick up some paint here. And what I did here was putting the shadow in. And so I take a little bit of a brush here also to kind of smooth it into a shadow. So it just kind of bleeds it into there.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're seeing it's going to be looking like this one. It's just getting their shadows in. And I always am remembering where your light source is when you're doing shadows.
So when you're saying remember where your light source is.
Like if you're painting on a sunny day, like say one of those, always remembering where your light's coming from so all your images will be the right light source. Like if you were painting this one and started and switch the light source around.
Okay.
Well, like the sun.
Okay, yeah. Just in watching it, you know,
yes.
I mean, you can, just in watching it, you can see the shadows
So
form,
all these
right?
are going to be the same.
Mm-hmm.
This has the light source coming in from this, from your right.
Mm-hmm.
If you have questions, I'm going to, that'd be great, because that way. But this was just showing some of the color here, which is similar to this one. And I won't put all the color in because I'm going to do the second level. So this was the first level that I did with the colors. Again, I'm going to just do a little blending.
Okay. So how, I mean, to start off then, I mean, you would just put one color down?
Yes.
I mean, okay,
yeah,
so like that's what you're doing.
This is going to be a daffodil. And what I did here is I used blue in all the colors. But if a daffodil is being painted, if I use blue and put yellow on top of it, it's going to have a green shadow. So you don't want a green shadow on a daffodil. So.
Right. So we're going to take basic colors.
Now we're going to take the basic. And I do have, other than the tube, I also have a palette that I use too, which just might be a little bit easier showing you when I'm going to do the yellow on the daffodil.
Okay. So is this what a beginner would more likely
get?
You
could
get this palette.
Just a little palette. I think it's really neat for me because there's 100 colors here. So when I'm painting, I can just go from color to color.
Okay.
And so, of course, rinse in between each color.
Okay.
So that's why you have your water.
Can we show that palette so that,
yes.
You know, our viewers at home can see
this
that?
This is a palette here.
Know.
That.
Okay, there we go. That's good.
Yeah, so
you know.
So
I think, you know what, that reminds me of what maybe I had when I was a younger child.
Of course, these
not
are
that, not 100 colors at my disposal.
These are all hard caked. So
yes.
Were these, like I said, I like to use out of the tube because the color is fresh. And so I mostly use out of the tube. But I like this because, especially for a demonstration, instead of bringing like all my colors,
sure.
I have it right here, so I'm going to dip into the yellow color here.
Now that let me ask this question too for everyone.
Yes.
Is that wet, or do
no?
You have...
This is all dry.
Okay.
And so as if I need more colors going at once, that's why I bought my little spritzer bottle. But right now I'm just going to be using the one.
Okay.
I'm just going to put it on top of the daffodils so you can see what happens. I put that yellow there.
Okay.
So that's bringing. You can see the shadow is there. So
okay.
You can see it just brings the yellow, but this almost turns into an orange, which is what a daffodil would have, like mm-hmm. an orange shadow. Let's see if I can.
Well, sometimes different colors get into flowers and we don't even think about that.
And I
guess that's because of our friend the bees, right?
Yes. You know? And I put a little, I thought a little ladybug would be nice.
Oh, there.
I like to put little animals and little bugs and.
Yeah.
So that, you can see how that turned more of a pink, more of a.
And you have a very light touch, right? You know,
yes.
you're not going very.
That's one thing about watercolors is you can layer, which is nice. You can't really do that as much in oils once the color's down, but you can blend. But with watercolors, you can layer so
because
you can build
it's
the color
thinner.
Up.
It's
yes.
thinner, correct? You
yes.
know the consistency.
Like this one, I think I have a yellow out. Actually, I have more of a brown here, but I'm just going to put that on top here so you can see. If you want to even darken the color a little bit more, I have a tube here that's out already, and I'll just darken it a little. So there's like three layers on this daffodil.
Well, here again, someone who's not, you know, who remembers watercolors from a long time ago or who's never done watercolors, how does that become a watercolor in a tube?
Oh,
you know?
it's neat because it's all, this is a company called Daniel Smith. They're in Washington State, but they're all over. You can get mm-hmm. them in Dick Blick and
okay.
all the different, and it's neat because you just squeeze out the color. It might waste a little bit more paint, but it also brings the color brighter. I think I can just take this over here. We're just going to put this. We're not going to worry about shadows, but we're just going to show. And that's coming right out of the tube.
Mm-hmm. So you're careful then. You try to only squeeze out so much
yes.
that you're, you know, that
you're going to. I'll take a tissue, too, and I'll just pick up some of the color.
Oh, okay.
That way, and then if I want to put it a little bit darker and I don't want to use another layer underneath, I'll just go and it'll just bleed right into it.
Oh.
So you can try too if you want.
Oh yeah. Well, I'm kind of wired here, but you know, I mean,
oh, yeah.
you know, so no, that's, so I can take one of these brushes?
Yes. Yeah. If you want to, yeah, that's
this
perfect.
One?
It's the same size as this one. And if you
well.
Wanted to do some.
So
take
where
some
do you
green. Oh, and here's some water.
I have
water.
Some green.
I'll grab you some water here.
Okay.
Put this here so you can still see that.
And then do I need to dab in here
yes.
a little bit?
Yeah, just
okay.
just get your brush wet.
Just a little bit.
And you can maybe put some green on the
okay.
on the tulip.
And would I start in here?
Yes, yeah, just start there. Perfect. And then
okay,
take,
folks. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, see, she's...
I'm an artist.
I'm an artist.
I'll ask. That's so much fun. And then you get the, I mean, you
yeah,
just do
just,
it. It just
you
happens,
just go
you know?
Just kind of like there it is. So we'll both be painting at the
yeah.
same time.
So much fun. Okay, so then, and then you add the water to this.
Yes.
Okay, and then you just.
And the nice thing is there's so many different brushes. I brought all. Pointed brushes.
Okay.
And I also have flat brushes, but I like, especially when I'm doing detail, to have a point on my brush.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, let's talk about brushes.
Yeah,
okay.
There's different
yeah.
kinds. And,
okay.
Some of mine, the ones I have now today, they have a long handle. There's shorter handles, but mm-hmm. I like, it's for demonstrating, I thought it would be great to have the longer so you could mm-hmm. see what I was doing rather than be up real close. Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess if you're doing finite work, right?
Yes.
You know, when you're putting those stitches on your quilts because yes. you're noted for that, you know?
Yes.
I mean, you know,
yeah,
put,
I do. And then,
put the little stitching onto the quilts that you do.
Yeah, I just do like the little, I'll just
they're
do
just
here.
Tiny.
Kind of like if I'm doing a stitch, I'll just go, I need to get some color on that. Let's see, I'll just do like a little, I'll put some green here. Let's just make believe we're going to stitch this
okay.
little guy. So we're just kind of.
And then you add those.
But it's nice because the point. Yeah. Now, if you try to do that with a flat, mm-hmm. it wouldn't work. So that's just having little stitches.
Okay, so do the brush. Okay, so you said you like a lot of fine brushes. So
yes.
Is that the most versatile brush?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the most.
And then what is the next brush you use? Like a.
I do use some flats.
Okay.
Like if I was going to do up here, this is called where you do a wet. I'll show, just show you up here. If this would have been a flat here, if I was going to do, let me just see if I can get that here. Sometimes you can do with this here too, and then you would take a flat brush and you would just blend it. That's kind of like a blending.
Oh, okay.
So then it would go from dark to light. I do that a lot in my skies.
Skies, that's
yes.
what I, you know.
Or if I'm doing the woods.
Grounds.
Maybe
yep.
doing the leaves through trees, you just start with the darker. And then you blend it with fresh water if you can. And it just kind of blends down. And then as you go down with more water,
it
gets lighter and
yeah.
lighter.
Yeah. So here again, you know, if that were, you know, the I'm going to say grass.
Yeah, just, or the trees or the
trees,
leaves or something
yes,
in the
yeah,
background.
Yeah, very nice, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so like I
so
said,
I'm just going to kind of keep going
then,
here.
And then I'll do, see if I can get, I'll just do the robin here. I'll just give him a nice red mm-hmm. orange color. Since we'll be seeing them soon.
Hopefully, yes.
I've had a couple in my yard.
Oh, so yes.
Hopefully the fox doesn't see them. He has gotten some birds. Somebody's gotten some birds out.
Yes, I think our viewing audience, you know, is going to just want to go out and get those watercolors now,
yeah,
you know, because you make it,
oops.
It, you make it fun. And here again, not all of us can be as good as you.
It's lots of practice. I always tell people, I think it's always lots
it's,
of practice.
Yes, yes.
If you practice anything, you're going to get really good at it.
You know, so. Right, and you want to do it.
Yeah,
you know,
you have to have
stuff,
the passion
you know.
For it,
yeah.
too. And I'm always excited when I paint in my mm-hmm. studio. I'm always happy to get up there and do some painting. So the excitement that carries through
yeah, yeah.
for it.
And especially, you know, it's kind of soulless, you know. I mean,
yes.
you're there alone, you know, and it
yes.
kind of, you know, you come home from a busy day at work,
yeah,
you know, and you're all harried or something.
Yeah.
I'm going to do some painting after, you
do,
know.
And I paint all hours. I like to get up early in the morning
uh-huh.
and paint, but sometimes at night I have special lights in the studio and I find myself, rather than watching TV, I cope and paint.
Yeah, very nice.
I do
yeah.
that a lot. So I just, yeah. and this too was what I did with this was the, I'm going to show you how that looks too with the different, there's the blue shadows and I'm going to make that daffodil a real nice.
You're going to show
nice,
about shadowing.
I'm going to do a pink daffodil.
A pink daffodil.
So you can see the blues coming through.
So when your teacher, you know, taught you or, oh, okay, I like
that.
That
way, yeah, that way, see if you.
Oh.
It's a little bit paler, but you can still see the blue shadow
mm-hmm.
coming through. And I'll do that with this too, so you can still see the blue shadow. I like pink daffodils. Pink dogwood's the best.
Mm-hmm.
Did I say daffodil?
You did say daffodil, you know, but I thought
you know
maybe.
What I meant.
I thought in the Allentown area they might be pink daffodils. I didn't know.
Pink daffodil. I've never seen a pink. Has anybody out there seen a pink daffodil?
We'll get questioned on that later.
You never know. Somebody's going to probably come up and say there are pink daffodils.
I was going to say different bees, you know.
Yeah. So you can see how the shadow is still coming and then make dab, but you
and
see
then
it's
just
still
by
coming
dabbing.
Through. So
yeah.
You know, if I want to go crazy, I can use a little bit of a watercolor pencil. This is water. I can put some lines in there.
Okay, now she's throwing in another tool here.
Another tool.
Watercolor pencils. Yeah, and we see those. I see those, you know, in art stores.
Yes.
How do you use a watercolor pencil?
They're nice because if you get them wet, they're like watercolor. So do this one here, and you can see.
So do you use that specifically for finer work?
I do.
Or smaller projects?
Yeah, sometimes I cheat, and I use it for the veins.
Oh, she cheats.
See there, I'm cheating.
Okay, but
rather than having to dip the brush in to make the little, I can also do it this way too with the little brush. Let me come over here and get, I have a real little brush.
Oh, okay.
Oops, there it is.
This one?
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do it this way too with the, but then you're dipping in paint a real lot to get the.
Okay, so the finest, I mean, that is a tiny brush, you know,
yeah, so you
very fine. So
too.
You usually use that.
Yeah, that's what I usually use for lines. Mm-hmm. But if I'm doing several things, I'll just grab a pencil. Or sometimes I've even done this too, use the bottom of my paintbrush and go on and make a line with that too. So I've done that. Because
okay.
When the paint is wet, you can do anything with a. Mm-hmm. With that. And as it dries more, you'll end up with a white line.
Okay. So let me ask you to make a really boo-boo on there.
Okay.
You know, what you would call
what
you would consider a boo-boo.
See.
You know, like either you used the wrong color or in your drawing it went too far. How would you correct that?
Let's see. Like this one, I actually put some green on by accident when I was
dipping
into here.
Okay.
The shadows, so I'm going to have to go in here, get the gray, and get a little bit of blue.
Okay.
And then I'm going to correct it.
Okay, because you used the wrong color.
Use the wrong color. So.
Okay. And so you can't erase it.
No,
you just go over it.
And then I can go over, but mm-hmm. No, it's nice because there is a little bit of the green showing
mm-hmm.
through,
sure.
Which actually, if you look at feathers or anything on a bird,
right.
It's multicolors, just like leaves on a tree.
Mm-hmm.
It's not one color, it's like a whole bunch of different colors.
So I was trying to get to the point that there's no such thing as a mistake.
There isn't. When I started doing art, somebody told me one time that there was rules, and I even actually juried a painting in a show, and they told me I broke some rules. And I said, rules? There's rules in art? Isn't it supposed to be creative and fun?
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
And so years later, the same people that didn't jure me in tried to get me to come in to talk to them. I'm thinking, well, you want me to talk about rules? But it was funny because that was one thing I always, when I did teach briefly, mm-hmm. I taught a lot of children, and
uh-huh.
I always told them there's no rules, just have fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was good. I thought you were going to say that you coined the phrase, rules are made to be broken.
Yes, they definitely are.
Yeah. Okay, so that was interesting. Now, let me have you make another mistake.
Okay, sure.
And, like, totally go out of, could you correct it? If you went into the, you know, got your paint in the wrong part of the drawing.
Yeah, let's see.
That you did. I know, I'm challenging you here.
Because
you don't make mistakes.
I never know. Of course I do. Like, let's say, like, this one is, like, let's say, yeah, so I went up like that or something.
Okay,
then you'd have to.
So what would you do?
I would probably go and take a lot of water.
Oh, okay.
And I would try to get that up with a tissue.
Oh, okay.
Grab a tissue here.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to take this and do a lot of blotting.
Okay.
And as long as it's not a staining color, there are certain paints that stain the paper. So it doesn't matter how much you blot, it's going to go into the paper every layer. But this, fortunately, is not a staining one, so I would just keep blotting and take it out.
Okay, so you could. And then would you maybe, you know, if you still saw something, you'd have to just maybe add something into that?
Yeah, just add. You know, when I first started out in watercolor, sometimes you'd make a mistake in the sky.
Okay.
It's just like, what do? Add a bird?
Well, right.
So sometimes I did.
I
added like a bird coming through,
mm-hmm.
you know.
But
sometimes, especially if you make a mistake, like say you put this big red thing here in the sky or something, and it went like that.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you could make it into a, of course it wouldn't be an orange, but I'm just doing it so you can see. Maybe make it into a seagull or something.
Oh, okay.
And then you might have to come back with several layers of different colors.
Mm-hmm.
To kind of give him you know, give them some wings.
Yeah, to get that, you know, to get that in there.
A little bit of color on the end here.
Okay. Like. Yeah, because you just can't put a quilt up in the sky or anything like that.
No, you can't put a quilt in the sky, unless it was hanging on the clothesline. You know, and it was going in the breeze in the sky, so.
Yeah, because your paintings and everything are so, I'm just going to use the word dense. Dense with color,
yes.
Dense with, you know, items in your things. They're just beautiful,
oh, well,
you know,
you.
I mean, it's
thank
it's all full. So that's yes. why I thought sometime you had to go, oops, I did a
yeah,
boo-boo, and
done,
then you got something
I've
else
done.
There.
And sadly, sometimes I've had to start all over. If I really goofed something up, I've had to just start fresh.
Yes.
And
but
I've,
that's okay.
I've done that several times.
Really?
Even after having, you know, 100 hours in a painting, I have started over.
Yeah, yeah. Well, see, but that's the thing, you know, you don't have to worry about, I mean, you can be a little worried about it, but
yes.
that's not your focus. Your focus is, you know, enjoyment.
It, just
you know.
To enjoy the
yeah.
colors and the,
and,
you know.
And the creativity,
yes.
you know, and stuff. And that yeah. just makes you more creative, right?
It
you know?
Does. When you learn things, that's one thing I've noticed with painting. I'm always learning something. I never completely know what the paint's going to do. It's mm-hmm. a learning process forever.
Mm-hmm.
It never stops learning, mm-hmm. you know.
Now, this paper, okay, now there's different kinds of paper
yes.
that you paint on.
Yes.
Normally when you do, you know, your big paintings here, is that a
yeah,
different
this is
kind
a,
of paper?
This is, I call it the expensive. The expensive. It's
okay.
the three, they, when there's different weights. This
okay.
one's a heavy, almost like a cardboard.
Oh, okay.
Paper. There's also paints that are like, they call it 140-pound paper, which you can pick it up and it's
pretty flimsy.
Yeah, it's very flimsy.
Okay.
The thing is, with the 140-pound paper, you're supposed to soak it before you paint it and then stretch it almost like a canvas.
Oh.
But I'm too lazy to do that, so I buy the expensive stuff. And
oh, okay.
Then I don't have to stretch, but the thing that's about two with 140 pounds, sometimes the paper will buckle. So you notice all these paintings here, there's no buckling. I mean,
mm-hmm.
maybe a little bit of a wave, which will mm-hmm. straighten out. But with a buckle, sometimes there's like it's like an earthquake in the paper,
okay.
little waves everywhere. And so I don't want to have that. I'd rather just start with the good paper.
Oh, okay.
And if I do goof up a painting, the nice thing about this paper is I can turn it over. There's no buckling. And I can...
Oh, so you know, can
sometimes
paint on the
people,
other...
when they buy a painting, they get two paintings.
They get two paintings.
Something on that.
That's good to know.
Yeah, so if you ever bought an original, check on the back. You might have a second painting.
Yeah, so you have to frame them on both sides.
Yes. There has been one painting I did at the Kutztown Folk Festival. I was demonstrating, and I turned it over to use it, and they both turned out great. I was like, which one do I frame?
Yeah. Oh, okay. So did you double frame it?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
is
I
that...
actually kept it because I didn't know which one to do. They're both really good. And
yeah. Could you do that? Could you double frame it?
I think so. I think you could change them by the seasons.
I think we just came up with another one.
Yes.
Very interesting. Yeah. So the paper, you know, so someone starting out then with, you know, you would certainly start out more with this 40
yeah, that
pound. Is that what you
fun.
Look for
yeah.
then in the
just
in the
get a, something that's not as expensive. Like this first sheet is like $25.
Oh,
but there's
okay.
two, I mean, it's double this size.
Sure. Okay.
But you can get the other like 140 pound for less, a lot
mm-hmm.
less.
Yeah, when they go into the craft store,
yes.
you know, and
or you can get Bristol board and
mm-hmm.
okay, and do paints
but that's
on that.
What they would look for. Okay,
yes.
Then there's different textures too. Now
yes.
I remember when I did watercolor, like back in high school, you know,
yes.
art class and stuff. It almost was textury. You
yeah,
know?
I mean, that's the cold. They call it cold press.
Cold
it's
press.
It's more of a
cold press.
And I do use that. This one is actually this is called hot press. So they take out all the bumps in the...
Okay, there's no... Yeah, because I was
no
going to say, I feel
smooth.
No
it's almost like Bristol board, but it's heavy.
So what's Bristol board?
Bristol board is more like for... And I have one here, pen and ink. I do use some pen and ink sometimes, too. So this
oh, we're
is,
getting all her
yeah, so we're
tricks
all
of the trade here.
So we're getting all the... So it's more for pen and ink. The thing about the cold press, if I did this with the pen and ink on the cold press... It would be all bubbly as it's doing it, but this
right,
is all
right.
smooth. So this, I can use pen and ink on this too, and sometimes I do use some ink in my painting. Like if you notice the feathers here,
mm-hmm.
before I painted this, I did use some ink.
Before you painted?
Yes, yes.
Oh,
so I did
okay.
put some ink down, hoping you would ask that question.
Oh.
So.
I told you, I'm an inquisitive person.
Even he has the little head here. It has some ink. So I do use ink. I love pen and ink. That's how I started. Besides the sketching, I did a lot of pen and ink.
When you were sketching?
Yes.
With your sketching?
With my sketches.
Oh, okay.
So I was always using the ink. And in those days, you had ink was hard to use because you had to fill
you had
the
to,
ink. It was, remember the ruling
the
pens?
The ink well, right?
Yes.
Is that what you...
And now,
okay. And now
us,
they're
they
ink.
Give us pens with...
Yeah.
They give you little wells, and there's a little well in here.
So you fill that inside,
I'll,
right?
Yeah, I'll open. It's real easy to open, so I'll just...
Yeah. No, that's very nice.
So you just fill this up.
Right.
It's a little well. Mm-hmm. Fill it all up with ink, and... It lasts quite a lot of applications mm-hmm. before you have to
now,
fill it
Now, would a calligrapher, would that be, a calligrapher
yes,
would use,
I'm
could
sure
use that too? I'm sure that that's how
that
it is too.
Too
because
you remember
they
you had to
sure,
it.
Absolutely.
And technology,
we did,
right?
Yeah, and we did that, you know, but this makes it a little more accessible, not
yes.
as, it doesn't look as daunting,
no.
if I can use that word, you
well,
know.
It's,
I think
it's kind it, of, even with painting, sometimes constantly dipping in the water and the paint, the water and the paint. Mm-hmm. Nice thing about ink is, you know, in time, and I'm sure they have it already. I think I did get a brush to test. They have wells. They might have a well where you can get the paint already in there, just like this. So
oh, okay.
I think they're out there. So I have to try to. That's my next experiment. So.
Oh, okay. Well, and art and crafts keep on evolving.
They
you know,
do.
I mean, just like our forefathers. You know, I mean, you know. Well, you know, in the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen, there's many traditional artists and craftsmen,
yes.
and they work, try to work in the ways that the forefathers did, you
yes.
know, and whatever, and a lot do. And my husband, who's a woodworker, he always likes to say, you know, seriously, if they had this, they would have used it.
That's true.
You know,
that's
you know
very
I mean,
true.
But they're still, you know, doing it in the traditional ways, you know, and stuff, and. Those are the best ways, you know. I mean, sometimes
I think so
you just
too.
Sometimes you just can't get any better than what they did,
I
you
think
know.
So
and
too.
Stuff,
I
you know,
I
especially,
agree.
You know, I mean, with joinery and that. But I look at the paintings. You know, we were talking about. I'm going to go back to Michelangelo or
oh,
you know,
yeah.
You know, Leonardo da Vinci. You know, when they
Everything.
Did those. How
I
you
know.
Look at those and how beautiful they are.
They did
and
all.
We're still similar today, though. I
yes.
mean, you know.
But to be able to do that, I mean, just take it and just like. The human body and just paint like that. I mean, I don't do people that way. I very seldom do people because mm-hmm. there's so much emotion in a person. I guess I get better emotion from when I do the animals and the.
Well, you bonded a long time ago.
Yeah,
you know?
That's true.
In the woods.
Yes, that's true.
You know, but I think everyone, an artist, you know, who goes on to do their art. I mean, they have a they're passionate about human. You know, doing humans
oh,
or
yes.
doing animals or, you know, I had a friend in school. She was very talented in drawing, but she loved drawing horses. And
oh,
I mean, and that's
yeah,
where,
that's
you know,
a,
and
that was her passion.
That was her passion. And that's what you saw in
yeah,
all her
I think
drawings.
That's it too.
And,
you have you know. To have a passion
mm-hmm, yeah.
for people, for mm-hmm. animals, for flowers.
For whatever. Yeah. You know, so.
Quilts.
Yeah. Yeah. But you, so how would you start, how would you tell a person to just start? Can you show us a little bit about
yeah,
drawing?
Let me just see. Oh,
maybe
yes.
say like drawing.
I did bring a pencil, and then what I do? Well, actually, I use a watercolor pencil
okay.
because it's still similar.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, let's say I wanted to do a pansy,
mm-hmm.
which is something I usually start out.
Okay.
There's the center, and I always like pansies because they smile. So
they do.
They have a little smile in there, and then they're. So you just start out drawing,
mm-hmm.
and then there's their two, and then if you, they have a little color here.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're
like
very
there.
Colorful, aren't they? You know,
and
I mean, they have a lot of shading.
Here. And then they got more up in here, and then of course they have their leaves coming
mm-hmm.
out. And then there's some color down in here too. They have like a little bit of a. So I would just draw.
You would just
start
draw.
Out drawing, mm-hmm. and then if you're going to paint,
mm-hmm.
you're going to take your colors, and then you can do from there. You can start the painting. I'm going to put some purples in here. Whoops, I hope I'm dipping into purple.
Now, may I ask you a question? Would you start in the middle and work
yes.
out, or do you start on the farthest edges?
I would start like right here.
You start there
middle.
And work out.
I did dip into the wrong color. Oh, we did a blue.
There is no such thing
There's
as a wrong color.
I think. I think I got the right, you know what, I end up with the gray, so we'll have to do a, that's a mistake, so we'll put the gray down, and then we'll put something on, it's more of a green, so we're going to put a purple on top of that. Let's see if we get a purple. Actually, do I have the pink out, so let's, let's do the pink. That way we have more of the rich, and we're going to do, in here, we're going to do the, and then we're going to have that. It would start out like that. Mm-hmm. And then I would probably go in with my, my little shadows here, too, because this is going to be coming again, the shadow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's some. There's a lot of shading in a pansy, right?
Yes.
I mean, you know, so that's a really that's a really good starting place for our viewers at home, you know, getting interested in watercolors.
They're going to do some leaves. They're going to do maybe the leaf. I'm just going to make it, instead of worrying about the shadow, I'm just going to make it one color here.
Yeah.
So it's so can see.
And it's like appearing before our eyes.
I love pansies, you can tell.
Yes.
I said they're happy flowers. I always think they're smiling. And then you might want to just take a little bit more water.
And that's what I'm thinking, you know, someone starting out would just appreciate being able to get something done.
Yes. So just start out with your little smile.
Yeah.
Always remember, you're gonna, they're smiling. And then we're going to give him a little bit of a, see if I got the right colors here. And that's a purple. It better be a purple. For some reason, even though I'm dipping on a purple color, it's coming out. Maybe something got stuck on there.
Oh, okay. And here again.
More of a mauve-y kind of
color. Oh, yeah. That's pretty.
And then?
Shaded.
Shaded all in there.
Yep. Well, I think you've given everyone a really good, you know, start on doing that, you know, on getting into watercolors.
I'll put some yellow. Oops, it was supposed to be yellow. Let's go over here and get
Yep, there's some yellow.
See, there I goofed a little, but what I do is I'm just going to dab in there. And
yeah, see, I never would have known about having that tissue. You know?
Yeah, I use a lot of tissues. You come in my studio, you see tissues all over. It looks like I've been crying all day, but no, I haven't. I've been dabbing. A friend of mine calls it dabbing.
Dabbing, yeah, okay. But the tissue is the best thing to use,
yes.
Right?
I mean, oh, yeah, you know, definitely. I mean, you know. If you use a paper towel, then you're carrying color. The nice thing about you can pretty much use just a little area.
Sure.
But if you use a big paper towel or something, then you're doing color everywhere.
Mm-hmm. And I'm just gonna, well, paper towel has more texture.
Sorry about that. Let's get another one. I'm just going to just do here so I can do some color. Oh, it dried too much, but I'm going to just do some lines in there. And then I'll do some of the purple, too.
And also, now, if you... did do something really wrong, and you did show us, you know, how to get it off of there, you know, and that. But if you added a little water, could you lift some of the color?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yeah,
okay.
I do all the time. Like I said, the only colors that stain, there's like a color called sap green.
Okay.
And it's like, once you put it down, it's there.
It's permanent. There.
It's not going to go away, so.
Okay, and is that a different kind of paint when you're calling it stain color?
Yeah, staining means there's certain colors, I think, like the phthalo blues, and they stain.
So okay, so I mean that's not a certain category of
no, it's
paint.
Just the color.
Oh, okay, color just the color itself.
Yes.
Okay, so those are called stain colors, and you're not going to get rid of those. So
just look up which ones are staining, so you know.
Yeah. Very, very nice. Okay. Well, I think we gave them a good start.
Oh, good.
So we know, you know, the pointed brushes and the flat brush. And is there a round brush? I mean, is there something like a round brush?
What they call this round also. Well, this is thicker. So this is more pointed, and then this is a thicker round. So it holds more color. The bigger the I call it the belly of the brush.
Oh, okay.
The bigger that is, the more
color
it holds.
If you're working with a larger thing, we're kind of scaled.
Yeah, and it makes a bigger, this one makes a bigger point, too. So more, where this one is just a smaller.
Okay.
See if a smaller point.
Okay.
You can see how wide that is compared to that.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Well,
you come on over here.
Thank you.
And I think we gave them a good...
I
think you...
I hope so.
I absolutely did. I think you did amazingly well.
Well, you did. You helped so much.
Well, I think I did pretty good over
there.
Yeah, I'm
going to frame that one. we'll have that in good
stuff. There you go. There you go. So, what would you recommend, though, that they go to these little... if the, someone wants to get started,
yes,
would you go to the little box of paints, or would you suggest?
I'd suggest the box, because okay, that way they have the colors in front of them. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm going against what I originally said with the hard colors, but as I got used to using the hard colors, I actually liked them. You know, and I'm not wasting as much paint, so I think too, you know, maybe get one tube of paint, maybe get a green or a blue, because they're the colors you're going to use the most.
Green and blue.
Green and blue.
Okay.
And so, you know, and a yellow if you want to make the green rather than, mm-hmm, and then you have the yellow too.
Well, if people would get the three basic colors and then they
can
could
add,
mix
yeah,
them,
they
or
can
they can mix them,
colors,
right?
Yes.
You know, do you do that a lot?
I mean, I do. Okay. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because. Mm-hmm. To make the other color, because you can take red and you can take yellow, and then you
yes,
can get orange
yeah,
out of there.
Yeah, then you get the orange, mm-hmm, and that's what's nice about dipping in there too. You know, I can just dip around, mm-hmm, and you always make sure the brush is clean before you dip into the hard color, because otherwise you're carrying the darker color into.
So how do you do that if you don't invest in a lot of brushes, you know, at one time, or do you suggest?
Yeah, I just keep. Cleaning
it just water, with water,
just
and then
water,
wipe it.
Or maybe have the little spray bottle, which I didn't use, but you can spray on top of it and then get the color off. But just, again, your handy tissue.
Okay.
Dabbing.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, to start out, if you're really interested in it, it's not super expensive
to get started
in this, you know, but then you get carried away like you did.
I did.
Many years ago.
I did. I used to order from catalogs a lot, mm-hmm, and in a pinch, which I really like. I love having an art store, Dick
Blake. Sure. Mm-hmm.
There's not many in the area.
Mm-hmm.
There's
okay,
like that one.
And then your work surface here, do you
yes,
paint mostly flat, or do you like this on the angle?
I'm mostly flat.
Oh, okay.
Really flat, yeah.
Oh, okay.
When I moved from Oregon back to Pennsylvania, I had a beautiful drafting board that went up and down, and I broke it in my move, and I never replaced it, mainly because it's one you have to put together.
Oh, okay.
I don't have a handy person. So I ended up getting this, and I still find myself painting flat.
You still find yourself
yeah,
painting
I'm still,
flat?
And I stand when I paint, so I'm kind of always leaning into it.
Oh, okay.
So
was this comfortable, you know, for you
yeah,
to...
Yeah, this
you,
was.
You
I'm going to be using
you're gonna
this
be,
a lot more.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
I have a really nice table in my studio,
mm-hmm,
and I just have to put something on top to so rather get a drafting table again.
Uh-huh.
I'm just gonna
yeah, because this reminds me of a drafting table somewhat. You
it
know,
it really
mean, you
does.
Know, you
it
know,
came with a T-square too, so, of course, which we all know what those are.
Well, or some of us want to forget.
Yeah, I use a lot of T-squares in my drafting time.
Yeah, yeah. So do you have any shows coming up, Diane, that you're going to be at?
Yes. Yeah, I'll be at the Lancaster Quilt Show.
Okay.
Down in Lancaster at the original, was the host, I think it's the Wyndham
oh, okay,
Hotel now, and that's March 29th to April 1st,
okay,
and then I will be at the Reading Berks Spring Festival.
Yes. Reading Berks, okay.
May 6th, I will be there, rain or shine. Hopefully this year we get a sunshiny day.
Yeah, that's
we did get rain last year, and we got a very strange cold, where our weather's been.
Yeah, that's out at the Reading Renninger's Farmer's
yes,
Market
I
out in Kutztown.
Yeah.
Okay, so
even if it rains, I'm coming.
Yeah, it's under the pavilion. It's very
yes,
nice out there. You know, everyone likes, as far as the craftsmen, they just love to go there because
yeah,
it's an
nice,
easy in and out load, you know, and
yeah,
stuff.
Oh, it's
and,
perfect. You can drive your car right up.
Yeah.
And, under.
And, you know, Renninger's is there, so you can do your shopping, get some good vegetables.
Yeah,
and
I did do some
whatever,
of that. There
there's
some
antiquing there,
yeah,
you know, and stuff. And you don't want to miss us there, you
no,
know.
No, you have to come. It's right before Mother's Day, so.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll
it's
see the, lots of
yeah,
nice gifts for Mom.
Yeah, yeah. And, yeah, the craftsmen enjoy that. And so we figured this year it's going to be really nice weather.
It is.
So
the
I hope Barry ordered
Barry
that.
Barry said the third's the charm, right? So
yeah,
we'll hold them to it.
Yeah, yeah. But jumping back just to your show quickly in Lancaster, that is a quilt show.
That is
and
quilts,
so,
yes.
Yeah, you
no,
know.
There will be quilts on display.
Mm-hmm.
display, mm-hmm. and there'll be a lot of vendors mm-hmm. selling
yeah.
mostly quilt-related mm-hmm. items
yeah.
And
then,
fabric.
And then right after the May show, of course, you'll be at the Kutztown
yes,
Folk Festival.
Yes, I will be at the Kutztown Folk Festival, definitely. I'm all signed up, so yes. they got me.
Yeah. Yes, and the Reading Berks Guild have a lot of craftsmen that do the Kutztown Folk
yes.
Festival, and we like working with Heather Zimmerman
yes,
out there,
so.
You know, and they have a beautiful quilt barn there. Yes. So that's where Diane is, in the
yeah,
quilt
the
barn
quilt
out
barn
at the
and,
Kutztown
and
Folk
Cindy,
Festival.
The director, is very knowledgeable
oh,
on
yes.
quilts. She's
yeah.
also giving a lot of talks on quilting
yeah.
in the area, so she'll be there to answer questions.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a good time.
No, thank you so much for coming
well,
out
you,
and
Kay.
Doing
thank
this
you for
today.
Having
you know,
me.
Well, you're
you made
very
it comfortable and easy. I was nervous, but Kay's always easy to talk to and easy to work with.
Well, I try, and I'm glad that you gave me this lesson because, you know, I sometimes, you know, think about doing these watercolors, and now I'm
you
thinking
should,
even
definitely.
More.
I'll give you more lessons, you know.
Oh, you heard her say that. And you had done this book. Now, you
I
said
did.
This is out of print,
yeah,
right?
That was
you
done,
know?
Oh, okay. It's probably 30 years ago.
Okay.
It was North Light Books, and they approached me. At that time, they were very big on selling art and craft books, and mm-hmm. they approached me about doing it. And it was, I had to take the pictures for the book.
Mm-hmm.
I had to do each
oh,
step by
did.
Step.
Oh, yeah.
So every step I did after I finished it, I would have to paint the
oh.
painting, and then I'd take a picture. And so mm-hmm. I did each step.
Wow, that was labor intensive.
It was. It took me, I forget how many months I had
uh-huh.
a deadline. So.
Wow.
Yeah,
yeah,
it was fun though. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, so there are other books out there that people can pick
yeah, oh,
up, you
yes,
know, and
yes.
stuff. And
lots of books.
And they can always contact you on
yes.
your website,
oh, Diane, I'd love to. Yeah.
DianePhalen.com,
yes.
right?
Okay,
yes,
definitely.
So.
Please do. I've always looked forward to talking to.
Yeah.
To everybody.
Yeah, very good. Well, we're so glad that you agreed to come out here
well,
and be my
you,
first
Kay.
Person
thanks for
here.
Having me
you know,
out.
So.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. Thank you.
Okay. So until next time, we will be waiting to see all of you coming out to our shows, and Diane will be waiting for you to come out to Lancaster.
Yes.
So we'll see you, and thank you for joining us, and take care and be safe. Good night.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen.